Welcome. My name's Cindy. I'm the director of MoMath. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome you to tonight's edition of Math Encounters. This is a wonderful presentation series, and our thanks, as always, go out to the Simons Foundation for supporting it so that we can keep bringing wonderful mathematicians here to inform, delight, and educate you month after month. For tonight, it's my great pleasure to bring to the stage a MoMath trustee to introduce another MoMath trustee. So we will start, first of all, with Christina Lewis, who happens to be not just the trustee of MoMath, but the founder and the president of All Star Code. So she's a superstar in her own right, but she's here tonight, not as the star, but to introduce tonight's presenter, John Urschel. Please join me in welcoming Christina Lewis.
Thank you so much, Cindy. And it is my great pleasure to introduce my fellow MoMath board trustee, John. But just briefly, I am Christina Lewis. I'm a philanthropist and entrepreneur who focused on closing the wealth gap, the theory of my work. And I'm the founder of All Star Code, which teaches coding, but focuses on Black and Latino boys, as well as Giving Gap, which is a donor platform that connects people and helps them donate to Black-founded nonprofits. I'm very proud to be a MoMath trustee. Even though I may be the only board member whose math education ended in high school, but it is a terrific honor to introduce someone like John and to learn from Cindy and all the other luminaries who come through the MoMath community. So John, before meeting John, I knew him by reputation beforehand, as many people do. He's sort of known as the mathematician who also used to be a professional football player. He spent three seasons as a Baltimore Raven. To learn more about John, I of course went to his website. His research is focused on graph theory, numerical analysis, and machine learning. He recently finished his PhD in mathematics at MIT just last year in 2021. And he's currently a member of the Institute for Advanced Study, which is a part of Princeton. And next year he'll be a junior fellow at Harvard University. And it goes on to talk about his thesis, graph principal minors, and eigenvalue problems. But I thought, I want to give the MoMath audience, a fuller picture of John. But I had to go elsewhere. So I looked, and I did not know until yesterday when I Googled John that he was also a New York Times bestselling author through his book, Mind and Matter, A Life in Math and Football, which he wrote with his wife, Louisa Thomas, who is very accomplished in her own right, a writer for The New Yorker, and the writer of two history books on American history. So here, I was able to give you all the full pictures. So John is a former offensive lineman for the Baltimore Ravens. In 2013, he won the Sullivan Award, given to the most outstanding amateur athlete in the United States, and the Campbell Trophy, awarded to the country's top scholar athlete. His memoir was called Captivating by Publishers Weekly, and has rave reviews from some of the best, most interesting writers in the country, including Walter Isaacson, who wrote the Steve Jobs biography, Adam Grant, and also some amazing mathematicians, Jordan Ellenberg and Steven Strogatz. I can tell John is almost getting nervous with how much I'm thinking about, but what is so interesting about John is how he understands how to put two different worlds together, and the exciting world of math, but also how it links up and is similar to professional football and his journey there. And that is what he's going to show you tonight, since this February Math Encounter is takes a football example but then shows how math can be used to solve it. So everyone, you are all in for a real treat to hear from John tonight. And it is my great pleasure to hand the Zoom floor over to him.
Wow, thank you, Christina. This is quite the introduction. First off, so yeah, thank you very much. And for those of you who did not know Christina before this event, I encourage you to look her up after this event, look at all the things she does. She's really sort of an amazing person. She does great work, and she's a role model of mine. So I can say that when I got to meet her first, like, I was very, very excited. So for tonight, I have a little treat for you. So the whole idea we have tonight, and I'm going to share my screen right now, make sure I get my technology working. The whole idea for tonight, let's see, you should all see my screen now. The whole idea is we're going to take a very straightforward looking math problem, and we're going to try to sort of solve it, or try to think about ways to try to come up with a good answer. And this math problem we're looking at, it's not sort of the typical math problem you see in school, which is typically, here's some set problem, you're trying to maximize something, you're trying to show two things are equal, or you're trying to perhaps prove something. Here, we're going to take a real world looking problem, which so happens to be related to sports. And we're going to try to see what we can say, what we can try to do, which is actually the way math shows up a lot in applications, especially sort of in what's called applied math. You have some question that you encounter in the world, and you want to try to figure out how you can answer this. And math is often a tool to do that. Okay. So this is the main setup. What we're going to do is I'm going to talk, we're going to do some exercises, we're going to have some fun for probably about 50 minutes. And then hopefully for about the last 15 minutes, we can just open it up for a wide question and answer, anything you might want to ask me, whether it's related to what I presented or not. And before we get started, the last disclaimer I want to say is I do want to apologize that we aren't meeting in person, we aren't doing this all in person, but COVID had been sort of pretty high in New York City, and I have my wife's like 8.5 months pregnant. So I really wanted to avoid like catching COVID and not being able to be at the hospital. So I hope you all sort of don't mind the online setting. All right, so top picks, how math can be used to rank sports teams. So Christina did a very thorough job of introducing me. But I think I'll just give you some brief cliff notes. So who am I? I'm a mathematician. I got my PhD in math from MIT. I'm currently a member for the Institute for Advanced Study, and I am a former NFL player. I played 3 years for the Baltimore Ravens. I played college football at Penn State. And the research that I do focuses on some really interesting areas of math that show up in a lot of applications. So what I work on is I work on things called matrices, which you can think of as arrays of numbers. If you got the MoMath Blast, which I requested, I think you all got a little PDF attachment, which was a nice little review of algebra and introducing you to some terms of matrix theory. And then I also do some research on graphs and networks and the ways in which certain sort of matrix representations of graphs can tell us things about. And so this event tonight is talking about a math problem that's related to football, but really it's going to be sort of a glimpse into some of the cool math that I get to do every day and some of the cool sort of higher level math that's out there, okay? And without further ado, let's look at this little slide, which I believe you all have been sent before this talk. So, what's going on in the slide? Well, we've got a nice little MoMath American Football League. We've got six teams. They've all got great mathy names. And they competed against each other for 3 weeks. And you can see we have the results from every single week. We have the record of every team. So for instance, in week one, the asymptotes beat the computers 23 to 10. And now, given this information, I'm just going to ask a very simple sort of like applied math problem, modeling type problem, where there's really no right answer or wrong answer, but you want to try to make good sort of estimates. My question is, given these six teams, the results from each week, how would you rank these six teams? How would you rank them? So take a second, take a look at the sheet, think about it, and rank these six teams for yourself, and think about the procedure you use to rank them. And then we'll sort of discuss different ways you all decided to rank these teams. And then I'll show you sort of a cool way you can try to rank them using some matrix theory and network theory. So I'll give you about 5 minutes to work on this and try to rank these six teams for yourself. And then we'll talk a little bit. Now would also be a great time for the survey.
And the more the merrier. Please feel free to let us know how many people are watching or even half listening with you. We'd love to know how many people we're reaching tonight. Thank you.
John, our population is rising ever so slightly. Maybe in a minute, give it another minute, and you might want to just run quickly over the explanation again.
Okay, I'll give it 20 seconds. And for first of all, if you could fill out the poll that's showing up on your screen, that would be great, just to let us know how many people are watching wherever you are. And for those of you who just joined, what everyone is doing right now, why we're sitting in pure silence, is we have a nice sort of imaginary MoMath American Football League, which you can see the sort of cross table for here. You can see the records. And all I'm asking is take a look at the teams, take a look at the scores, take a look at the results, and rank them some way from 1 to 6. However you think is the best way to do it. And pretty much we're gonna spend 1 hour of the time sort of talking about one cool technique, one way to rank them. It's not the best way, there's no best, but just thinking about the idea of how to try to come up with different models or answers to questions and how you think your way through them. Like a mathematician does. I like to think we're all sort of mathematicians in a way. All right, I'm gonna give it one more minute. I see a comment from Barney who says the tangents should be 0 and 3, not 3 and 0. So if you look at the scores of the tangents, so week one, they played the denominators and they scored 14 points and the denominator scored 9, which means they scored more points, which means they would win. The winning team isn't listed first, the teams are listed alphabetically each week. So I'll just give it one more minute for you all to think about it. All right, I'm curious. All right, I'm curious, how did each of you rank them? And for anyone who's willing to share, perhaps like, okay, not all at once so we don't have a disaster, but maybe, you know, if you have an idea, unmute yourself and maybe tell me how you ranked them and how you sort of came to your ranking. Like, what was your idea? What was your, you know, how did you discern between different teams?
I have one way to do it.
Okay.
One thing I looked at is like, I noticed that a lot of teams had tied records. Okay. So I looked at the outcomes because differential point, which puts the asymptotes in first, followed by the tangents, were then followed by the integrands, who are followed by the pyramids, who are followed by the computers, and then the denominators sit dead last.
Okay. I like it. Anyone else have a different way they did it? Rank by record within same record total points. Aiden, you raising your hand? What do you got for me?
I did it by who got the most points in each game and add them up and see who had more points. For example, the first one and the last one had the same record, but the first one scored more points in the games than the other team did. So that's how I did it.
Gotcha. No, that seems like a great way to do it. I like that plan. And I see some people have different rankings, but people used some really innovative and smart techniques. So that's great. So I like all these ideas. So this is what we just did. We ranked them. And now I'm going to ask, I have an idea of how we might rank them in mind. And I want to show you, it's just one technique, which I think is pretty cool because there's some math involved. And this involves the question of assigning. Oh, so Saul, I see in the chat, asked about point differential. So looking at point differentials, that's a really interesting idea. And JCK said point differential again being used. So now I want to lean into that point differential idea, which is a really good one, because here our idea of ranking with record and then ranking with, you know, total number of points or things like point differential, this seems like a really good idea. So let's try to lean into this a little bit more and try to ask ourselves the following question. Suppose we have these six teams and all these techniques we use were great. And Barney even proposed using the ELO method, which is a technique used to sort of rank chess players or score sort of a chess player strength. And the ELO method is actually a really good method for ranking teams. It can be a little tough for football teams. So Nate Silver and sort of 538, they used the ELO rankings. I don't know if they still do, but they used to do it to rank NFL teams. One key thing about the ELO rating is it takes a while to get good estimates. And so you need to play a lot of games. And so if you don't have a ton of games, the ELO method can be a tough one to use unless you have prior information. So they use the ELO method and it worked pretty well. But what they do, so JCK says they still use it. That's good to know. I didn't know if they still did or not, but they always use preseason information. So they don't start every single team at, you know, at 1500, let's say. They start with some sort of preseason approximation, which helps them get a good answer quickly. So that is a really good technique. But because we don't have any sort of starting information, let's try to think about how we can do this. Scott Oliver says, compare final records of teams that you beat. Beating better teams should get some advantage. That's another fantastic idea. How, suppose now we have these six teams and we want to give them a numeric value, kind of like, you know, an ELO ranking gives teams numeric values. A higher number, let's say, means a better team. If we assign every team a number, what type of property would we like these numbers to satisfy? So this is just thinking as a mathematical modeler. We have six teams. They all played each other. And each one has a number representing how strong they are. What property should these numbers satisfy with respect to each other, let's say? So for instance, if two teams played each other, maybe one natural thing you might want to do, because you might say, hey, I might want the score differential when two teams play to be the difference in their numeric value. So maybe we assign teams numbers so that the difference between the numbers corresponding to any two teams is actually the difference in score when they play each other. So that's one really natural thing to try to do. And this is sort of like the simplest, most basic type of idea you can try to use. So we take two teams, let's say we take the asymptotes and the computers. And the idea is if we have team Y and they beat team Z by 10 points, then we can assign them some score X, where we want X of Y minus X of Z to equal 10. The problem with this is someone, I hear a little bit of noise, but is someone trying to talk? No. The problem with this, well, I'm curious, how do we feel? Is it clear that this usually shouldn't be possible? Or is that straightforward? And one of the reasons why setting values like this so that they're always sort of the score differential is exactly what Matt said. There's round robin complications. And Karen very astutely said in the chat, the transitive property of winning football. Exactly, this idea of if team A beats team B and team B beats team C, then team A should beat team C. But we know in football, this doesn't always happen. You know, the Giants beat the Patriots in the Super Bowl. The underdog, you know, wins sometimes, and, you know, things happen. And for instance, in our own little made up football schedule, you'll note, if we just take the games between the asymptotes, the computers, and the denominators, we get three equations, one for each week. And then the problem we see is that if we add up all three equations, on the left-hand side, we get zero. And on the right-hand side, we get seven. So that immediately tells us that there's no assignment of numbers that can satisfy this property. We're asking for something too strong. What do we think is a relaxation of this condition that is something that we can actually do and hope for? Something that we can hope to satisfy? So instead of, you know, each pair of teams satisfying this property exactly, what's something we could try to ask each individual team to satisfy? And the reason why we're talking through it like this, the reason why we're thinking through it like this, is this is how algorithms or techniques to solve problems arise. You have some problem you're trying to solve, some applied problem. Here's an applied problem in front of you. There's many different ways you can solve it. And one way to try to get towards some technique is you say, I want my model to satisfy property X. And you see, can it satisfy that? And if it can't, then you try to get the closest thing you can. And just by doing the simple technique, we'll see in a second, we're actually gonna sort of back out, we're gonna get out sort of a very common and well-known ranking system for sports teams. And it's incredibly simple. So. What do we think? What's a weaker condition than this that we could ask maybe each individual team to satisfy? Any ideas? Oh, Chris Long is here. Thanks for coming. Yeah, no, that's definitely a very reasonable technique. And I should mention that here we're doing very low level, sort of very basic stuff so that the math is very straightforward and it's sort of, we're sort of assuming as little information as possible. each team's has its own net points for minus against for the season. So Eric's suggestion is, instead of making sure that each pair of teams who played satisfy this condition, why don't we make sure that this condition is satisfied for each team, and let's say the sum of their opponents. So the sum of these differentials for all their opponents satisfies the sum of the differences of their numeric values. Barney, yes, we're just constrained to scores, no yards gained, no time of possession. We're trying to use as little information as possible and get a very simple, elegant model out for this. Okay, so this second attempt, which sort of Eric mentioned, this is actually a known technique, and it's incredibly simple, but works surprisingly well, especially after you give it some modifications. The sort of version I'm going to tell you today is not the best in practice for a couple mild practical reasons that we'll get to later, but mild modifications of this actually work surprisingly well when you're trying to use sort of data agnostic sort of algorithms that only take into account sort of things that don't necessarily have biases. Okay. So this attempt is something called the simple ranking system. And it's such a simple idea. It's not actually clear who came up with it, who first sort of came up with this idea. If someone knows, please tell me, because it's not obvious to me. The idea is we just set our numeric values so the sum of the difference between a team and their opponent's values is equal to the sum of the score differential. So for instance, if we look at the asymptotes and all of their opponents, well, we see the difference between them and the computers, they beat them by 13. The difference between the asymptotes and the denominators, they beat them by 11. And the difference between the asymptotes and the integrands, they beat them by 12. And so we would want that 3 times the asymptote score minus the computer score minus the denominator score minus the integrand score should sum up to 36. And if we do this sort of very simple, we want this condition to hold on average. If we do this for every single team, well, what we get out is something really straightforward that those of you who aren't in high school will study in high school, and those of you in high school, past high school, have studied, is solving a linear system of equations. So we take the scores from each week, and we do the same procedure we just did for the asymptotes being this first equation, and we get out 6 equations. And now from these 6 equations, we want to try to solve for the numeric value of each team that satisfies this property. Okay. So far, so good. Any questions about what we've done so far? Any questions about what's happened so far? Okay, so Tom says it makes sense. And so let me know if anything is a little confusing or anything that doesn't make sense. And then know that from here, what we're gonna spend some time doing is we're actually gonna use some really cool math to try to understand, okay, we have these 6 equations, we have these 6 unknowns, and we're gonna try to understand, does this have a solution? Does it have a unique solution and why? And to do this, you actually need some math. And okay, so to start, the first thing I wanna do is I wanna make sure that we're all on the same page with some basics of algebra and some questions about how you represent equations as matrices. And math, HSRA, each equation represents the fact that, so for instance, this first equation, I should be able to write. Let me try for the very first time. This first equation, so not going to try to write. The first equation tells us that the average score differential for the asymptotes throughout the whole season is equal to the average difference of each team's numerical value. And Margareta, that's the great question. How can the rankings be fair if a team doesn't play every other team? That's sort of the big question, the big challenge, because some teams may play an easier schedule than others. Some teams may play a more difficult schedule. And so trying to find some ranking that really represents the strength of a team rather than just, you know, a record against who they play sort of independent of other things. Okay, so for a second, now let's take a look at this little slide. Well, this little two-page set of notes I sent you all, which I believe you should have gotten before this event, just to briefly review matrices, vectors, and solving systems of equations. Okay, so let me change my share. Okay, so all of you should have gotten this sort of before this event to look at and sort of review your solving systems of equations. So just to like talk through this really briefly, I hope you all looked at it first, but the whole idea is, how do you solve systems of equations? So a fun problem to think about, we have two kids here, Alice and Bob. Alice is 5 years older than her brother Bob, and in 2 years, she'll be twice as old as him. How old are they now? So this is the same type of problem you may have heard in high school. I'm sure for those of you who aren't in high school, you will see these soon. And so for instance, in this problem, you can represent Alice's age by A, Bob's age by B, and you get two equations. One says Alice's age equals Bob's plus 5. And the second tells us that in 2 years, Alice is going to be twice as old as Bob. So we get two equations down here, and we have two unknowns. One way to solve the system is we can subtract the second equation from the first. We get a value for B, and then putting B back in, we get a value for A, and we get that Alice is 8 and Bob is 3. Okay. And this is fairly straightforward. This technique we're using, subtracting these equations, this is actually a sort of specific example of something called Gaussian elimination, which is a technique for solving systems of equations. But I just want to, if it lets me, talk about this a little bit in the language of matrices and vectors, which is really related to my research. So a matrix is just a rectangular array of numbers. A vector is a column of numbers. And you can multiply matrices by vectors. And this can actually encode systems of equations. So we had this system for this made up problem for Alice and Bob that A minus B equals 5 and A minus 2B equals 2. We can write this as a matrix times a vector by writing 1 minus 1 and 1 minus 2. And the way you read this is 1 times A minus 1 times B equals 5. 1 times A minus 2 times B equals 2. And one thing you can do is that if you can find a matrix such that when you multiply them, you get this sort of matrix with ones on the diagonal and zeros on sort of away from the diagonal. This is something called the inverse. It's like you have a matrix, it does something to a vector. And now if you can find another matrix where if you apply it after, it sort of undoes the operation, this is called an inverse. And so one easy way to solve a matrix vector equation is if you find an inverse, you just multiply it on the left and you can get a solution. Okay. This is just a little sort of warm up to just give you some sense of these things. All right. Now I'm going to go back to our writing of the equations. And just by writing this in terms of a matrix, we can take these six equations and convert it into a matrix vector equation. And Michael astutely noted that if we sum up all the equations, everything will cancel out. And yes, these equations are ordered. Oh, and Renuka asks, do the values on the right-hand side tell us the rankings? The right-hand side is just pure score differential. So this is just the pure score differential against opponents. It doesn't sort of have any other information. If you wanted to look based off pure score differential, then that would be your ranking. But here we're just using score differential on the right-hand side. So now we have a matrix vector equation. And a thing we'd want to know is, when do we get a solution? Do we get a unique solution? Okay, and to sort of make this observation explicit, what Michael's saying, the fact that these all sum, if you sum all these equations up, you get zero on both sides, he's kind of saying this matrix is singular, so you can't invert it. And he's sort of kind of saying, because when you sum these up, you get zero equals zero, he's saying you can't solve this and get a unique solution, which we'll see. But I got news for you, Michael. We can still do things. Things will still be okay. And to help tell you mathematically why things are still going to be okay, we've talked a lot about matrices, but now I want to get into talking about networks or graphs, discrete objects and relationships between them. And so we're going to take a little aside into something called spectral graph theory, which is looking at graphs or networks, which is sort of discrete things and sort of pairwise relationships. So for instance, we have the schedule for our football team. We can make a graph or a network where the vertices or nodes are the six different teams. And we'll just put an edge or a line between two teams if they played each other. That's a network. And given this network, something really cool you can do, which is sort of a very large area of math with all sorts of really interesting applications, you can take a graph and associate with it a matrix, and information about that matrix often tells you really interesting things about the graph. And we're going to use a really common matrix representation, something called the graph Laplacian. So I put the definition up here for half a second for sort of people who have taken higher level math just to look at the definition. But the main idea is we're going to build this array of numbers where entries are going to encode whether or not two nodes are connected by an edge. So here, if you remember, this matrix, which is just the matrix that we got from our system of equations, turns out it's not just any old matrix. This matrix is actually just encoding the sort of schedule of our football teams. So for instance, we see a minus one here because the computers played the asymptotes. And we see a zero here because the pyramids did not play the asymptotes. And we see threes all along the diagonal because each team played three games. So this fully encodes our schedule. And the cool thing is these matrices called graph Laplacians have some really cool properties. And well, one property that really applies to us is the following. Well, I think Michael noted that, you know, you sum all these up and you get zero on both sides. And another way to sort of say kind of what he's saying, but to say something even a tiny bit stronger, is if you have any solution and you just add the same amount to each solution, you add some fixed amount to each solution, to each value, it's also a solution. You know, if we add one to each of these x values, they're all going to cancel out in our equation because you'll get plus three from the first term and then minus one from the remaining three terms. And so the thing you need to do is you need to fix what the sum is going to be, because the way our six equations are written, they don't tell us anything about what the sum of these values should equal. And so why don't we just set them to zero? And now my question is, if we set them to zero, the sum to be zero, now do we get a unique solution? And the answer is actually yes. And this answer, one way to see this answer actually in general is by using theoretical properties of matrix representations of graphs. So one cool property is that if our network is connected, meaning you can get from any one node to another one by some sequence of lines, then you actually know that you can solve this equation as long as your right-hand side sums up to zero. Because the left-hand side is going to sum up to zero when we add everything up, we need the right-hand side to sum up to zero. And this property of connectivity is really important. So if we had some, let's say, some football schedule where you could really break the team into two divisions and there are no cross-division games, well, we don't have any hope of coming up with a ranking because we don't have any information about how the two sides relate to each other. So this connectivity is really important. And this property guarantees us that we get a unique solution. And for people who are curious about how you actually show this mathematically, if we have some extra time at the end, I can sort of write a quick proof for you. And so this means we get one solution. And the question is how to solve it. Well, we have six equations and six unknowns. We could use Gaussian elimination, which is, I would say, the most well-known technique to solve a linear system. Yes, you could also use an SVD. I would say in terms of solving things by hand, SVDs are harder to do, in my opinion, than just Gaussian elimination, converting a matrix to, you know, LU form. But instead, for our purposes, we'll use a cool matrix theory trick. So to make our lives easy and to sort of move this night along, I'm just going to tell you the inverse of our matrix. And it's not a true inverse because, as Michael noted, our matrix is singular. We can't invert it. But I can produce a matrix here on the left so that when it's multiplied by the matrix we've been working with, we actually get this identity matrix out minus some small term that's just telling us that our matrix is not invertible everywhere. But we get more or less exactly the identity matrix. And so just by multiplying this inverse matrix, it's called a more Penrose inverse, but an inverse in some sense, by just multiplying the score differentials by this inverse, we actually get the unique numerical value for these six teams that satisfies all our conditions. Average score differential condition plus the condition that it sums to zero. And from that, we get a really simple ranking. We rank the teams, the asymptotes have the highest score, followed by the tangents, followed by the integrands and pyramids are actually tied with the same score, even though the integrands and the pyramids are tied with the same score. Interestingly, we have the computers, and then finally we have the denominators. Okay. So this is sort of a cool, very simple technique. Believe it or not, a modification of this technique actually does get used in practice in a little bit of sports analytics. And now I'm going to take and Karen asks a great question. Can you force a solution by setting one team to be a specific value? Yes, that is also a reasonable way to do it, although it gets more complicated, I would say, in that setting. But that's something you can definitely do. Setting them to sum to zero is actually really, it's a choice that's made with some knowledge of like how to make this as easy as possible, but you can just set one equal to a specific value. And now what I want to do is I just want to give you all a chance, for those of you who sort of really followed along, if some of this got a little away from you, that's totally okay. I just wanted to sort of show you how you can use you know, higher level mathematical techniques to solve cool sort of applied math problems like this. But for some of the time we have left, I thought I would give you a chance to maybe try your own hand at this technique. So what I have here is a little mini JV league. So instead of six teams, we have four. I have a schedule for you. So it's just north, west, south, and east. North plays west and east. West plays north and south. South plays west and east. I have score results. And I was just hoping you could maybe try to come up with a ranking using our technique, using this simple ranking system I mentioned. So, and the big hint is this matrix with twos on the diagonal and these minus ones on the off diagonal plus minus one in the corners. This is the matrix that's going to encode this condition for each team. And so I'm giving you the inverse on the left. And so if you can compute the score differentials for each team, multiply them by this matrix on the left, you will get the scores out. And I wrote the end part of this hint on my screen slightly different than the one you have because I wanted to make it a little more suggestive for you. All right, so take some time. I'll give you 4 or 5 minutes to try your hand at it if you want. But if you don't want to, we can also just hang out. So that was also a great time while people are working on it. If you have anything to say, anything you want to talk about, now's a good time. I just wanted to give people, you know, people who really followed along closely a chance to sort of try it themselves, which is a good way to really internalize techniques. So if you have any questions so far, feel free to let me know. I'll give it 2 more minutes. And if you do it on your own and you get numerical values out for each team or results, feel free to put it in the chat if you do. Tom says he missed the explanation of why this Moore-Penrose inverse causes the sums of the x's to be fixed. So this is related to the fact that this graph Laplacian, which we're taking the Moore-Penrose in. So I'm going to say stuff a little sort of higher math because the question is a little more technical one. The reason why the sum is the thing that's important to fix in some sense, is because if you take this graph Laplacian, which is this matrix we're trying to invert, the kernel of this graph Laplacian, the place where this graph Laplacian is singular, is actually, it's the same for like every graph Laplacian of any connected graph. It's just for any vector where all the entries are equal. And so if you want to be sort of in the subspace or you want to be orthogonal to that to make sure that you're, you know, somewhere where your graph Laplacian is invertible, the orthogonal complement to this all ones vector, well, what you need is the inner product between the all ones vector and your vector to be zero, which is the same as just summing up the elements of your vector. So that's why this idea of setting it equal to zero, it actually puts us in a subspace. Puts us in some subset of like, if we have n teams, then we're in n dimensional space. This condition puts us in an n minus one dimensional subspace where our matrix is actually completely invertible. It's not singular where we're looking. So that's a very mathy explanation. All right, so I gave you all a little bit of time. Yeah, it's a little bit of a mathy explanation, but there's something nice when you do some simple, cool sort of techniques, but there's really some interesting sort of like higher level math going on in the background. And this is the case here. The reason why this technique works is really some real cool math that hopefully some of you feel inspired to look up and learn more about. And I see a solution in the chat: west, north, then south, and then east. And indeed, if you take your four equations from these 2 weeks, you get these four equations where I ordered them, the equations north, then west, then south, then east. If you multiply the score differential on the left by this Moore Penrose inverse matrix I gave you, you get that north gets a score of 3, west gets a score of 4, south gets a score of -1, and east gets a score of -6. And so you rank them west, north, south, and east. And one interesting thing is that, you know, north and south have the same record, but clearly north is sort of viewed as almost as good as west, whereas south is sort of like very much viewed as like, you know, decently worse. And the interesting question here is, west is not undefeated, but the system puts them higher than north. They lost a nail biter to north, a 1-point game. But west really, they beat south pretty well. North also beat east pretty well, but south is a much better team than east. And so an interesting question here, which I did this example purposefully. Here our system says the best team is not the team with the most wins. So I'm curious, how do we feel about that? So is that a bug or is that a feature? I don't know. And I'd like to spend sort of, you know, a little bit of time asking. So Tom says it sounds realistic. Yeah, it's reasonable that sometimes the team with the best record isn't the best team, depending on what teams you're playing. But Michael says no, because they lost head to head. And so it's not an easy question to answer. And I'm not saying that, you know, this ranking here is the right one. I'm saying this is a ranking you get from a set of assumptions that you'd like to sort of satisfy and not taking in anything else. And so Tom thinks it's realistic. Michael doesn't like it. Yeah, Tom says there's chance, you know, there's, especially when it's a 1-point game, you know, you have a field goal, a tipped ball here, a fumbled snap there. So it's interesting to ask about, but now I wanna move into sort of the last something to think about. What are the flaws of this system that we looked at? What are ways we could improve this system? And, you know, maybe, and this third one is not something we really need to talk about here, but just something for you to think about to maybe take home, because I think these first two are really gonna take up enough time. If you wanted to, let's say, rank offenses and defenses rather than just teams, how would you adapt the technique? When would it work? Something to think about at home. Okay, so Michael, first great observation. A team that has a single blowout win but narrowly loses every other game could perhaps get a higher ranking than they should. So what would you do to fix that? So I can tell you that this ranking system is something that's actually used in practice by some like sports analytics firms. And I'd be curious, so all these problems that you're about to bring up, these have been sort of thought about. How would you fix that problem? I'm curious. And I'll tell you how this often gets fixed in practice. Michael also says you should add points for each victory. So Michael, you're absolutely right. One easy way to do this in practice is, first of all, in practice, you have home teams, away teams. You should probably give some benefit to the fact that a team is sort of away. You know, a team has to play away, they should probably get a little bit of benefit. And you should make sure that actually winning matters. So here, maybe you make sure that the differential between two teams has to be at least some fixed value, which really gives some benefit to winning. Okay. And how would you limit the effect of single blowout wins? I can tell you a really simple way, and this is actually like variants of what gets done in practice sometimes, is you just cap it. So when outliers sort of, when outliers can sort of skew your system, you cap it. Let's say if a team beats another team by more than a certain number of points, you just cap it by some fixed amount. So that these, so if, you know, a team beats another team by like 80 points, it doesn't like completely screw up the mean. Yeah, so these are two problems which you all sort of like very clearly identified in the chat, and the third problem of home and away. And these things can be sort of like readily modified pretty quickly to sort of adjust for that. But yeah, but this is one technique you can use. It's got some really cool math behind it, but I do want to stress there's this like not at all sort of like the only technique you can use. There's other techniques. People mentioned ELO ratings and other different types of ranking systems, but somehow that's the interesting thing about like applied math modeling problems. You have something you're trying to solve, and it's not immediately obvious that one technique is always going to be better than another in all settings. And so it's sort of, it's an interesting way to think about math, using math to try to think about ways to approach applied problems you sort of encounter in the world, like this one. Yeah, ranking the ranking systems. No, I mean, you can do this. You get different ranking systems and you see how they perform in different predictive settings.